with Paul Daner, Mark Shalafoo, from listener questions to some running gags. Insider stories, ambush live, that dad life and respect for flags. Kick off the weekend, all right? It's the Growler Friday Show, it's Who Dey Light.
All right, welcome into the latest edition of Who Dey Light. Paul Daner Jr., Mark Shalafoo here with you on Friday of the bye weekend. Happy bye weekend to you, Mark.
It's an exciting bye week, isn't it? When you get a little bit of snow in Cincinnati, a little bit of heat, you get all four seasons in a single week. That's Cincy weather at its peak right there.
Yeah, we're doing it. We're doing it. The weather always, I always love it when it snows the first time. I enjoy looking out and seeing snow. And then every time after that, I don't like it.
I know. It's like, give me one or two good snows just to drink some coffee, look out at the backyard and see it all covered up. One day of sledding, then I'm good. I don't need all the icy roads and tricky driving, randomly days off school. That always throws off the calendar. I don't need any of that.
No, the actual logistics of dealing with snow, not as cool as looking at it.
Right, absolutely. No question. What flag are you flying today?
Well, special flag is up. Happy birthday flag is up. It is it's my wife's birthday. Happy birthday.
All right. Happy birthday to the missus.
You know, gifts have been given. Every balloons have been thrown on her. That's how you have to wake up on your birthday around here. So the flag is flying. The balloons have been thrown. Celebrations. Celebrations everywhere.
That sounds like a birthday ambush more than a celebration. People are waving flags, throwing balloons in your face. Here's a gift. Move on with your life.
It's gotten a little more violent and aggressive as our kids get older, but it's okay. It's okay.
So what gift did you get your wife? Which Cincy shirts, Growler edition shirt did you give her? Was it the Growl Pal?
I actually did get her a Cincy shirt for her birthday one of two gifts. I got her Votto Forever Bangs. Votto Still Bangs is a shirt that she wears to Reds games all the time when we go. Now with his retirement, I loved the Votto Forever Bangs shirt. And so that was a layup gift. It's just a perfect shirt that can be worn now forever.
Yeah.
And I got her, it's a Taylor Swift thing that says, I cry a lot, but I'm so productive. It's an art. It's like something you put up in your office or whatever. So it's like a joke Taylor Swift saying from Torture Poets Department.
Oh, wow.
We're very Taylor Swifty here in this household. We got a lot of Taylor Swift fans here in this house. So I lean into it. I'm not going to fight it.
I think it would have been funnier if you just gave her a Growl Pal t-shirt and that was her. Here's the t-shirt merch from my podcast. Yeah. Enjoy.
Yeah.
You've earned
already got some of those. Got two big boxes of them. So any of our live shows that you come to, or if you're ever around or just want one, just let us know and we'll deliver them. We're going to get to the point where the games might mean so little that I just spend the first half going around finding Growl Pals in the seats that send me where they're sitting and I just deliver them t-shirts.
Yeah, you're just
we're not far from that.
Just a Growl Pal Santa Claus at that point, going around seat to seat. Here's your prize. We brought it into the stadium for you.
It might deliver more of a story and something more of interest than anything that's going to happen on the field if this thing continues to circle the drain. But we're not going there yet. Don't worry, you guys are taking us there. We're gonna go through it. Thank you to everybody that sent their questions into the growlerpodcast@gmail.com. We are gonna get to a few of those a little bit later on, but we've got a lot of other stuff we're gonna get to. I did mention our live shows. Those are still going on. Our next live show is plotted for the Thursday night game. So it'll be the Bengals Browns Thursday night game on the 19th. When that goes down, we will be doing our pregame show like we've done on the night game shows, which usually ends up being about 4 o'clock, usually when we start that thing. So you can come on down. We'll be doing giveaways and games, all that stuff. So that will be our next live show, but still a ways off on that one, but that's down at Nation Kitchen and Bar at the Banks, BetMGM. They do UFC shows down there now that have become really popular. They don't have no covers or anything, and they've gotten big crowds in there for those UFC events. If you're looking to get down there, and again, you can always reserve any table for any big event down there, nationkitchenandbar.com. They've got tons of screens, good food, good drinks, all that stuff. So head on down there. Next week, Mark, I am on vacation next week. With the bye week and Thanksgiving holiday, take the fam out for a little Griswold family vacation as we get away a little bit. But tons of content still coming your way. We are recording. We're going to have a Burrow-sode for you next week. All things Joe Burrow. I've talked to a ton of people for it. Myself, Jay, Charlie Goldsmith's going to join, Dan Pitcher, Brad Cragthorpe. You're going to hear from some other quarterback gurus, if you will. We're going to go all in his season. What's next? Every aspect of Joe Burrow coming up for you next week. Mark and Jay are going to have a show together.
Let's go.
That's kind of fun.
That is fun. A nice little change of pace.
Yeah, excited for that. That, and then I also am talking to Bill Cook about his book on Greg Cook. It's a lot of rhyming there, but you haven't heard about it or seen it, you should check it out. And I'll have a conversation with Bill next week. Awesome book on legend, Cincinnati kid, the original Cincinnati kid, Greg Cook, and it's an incredible story. And he spent a ton of time diving into it. So we'll talk to him on that. What's your favorite Bengals story this week, Mark?
It's just watching Joe Burrow and Ja'Marr Chase play football together. And that, to me, is the one thing I'm holding on to as a Bengals fan, is the fact that the two of them are so freaking good that they can pull this team that clearly blew it in free agency. The defensive signings have just given you nothing. Rankins continues to be a zero. Geno Stone, you're just wondering when he's going to start making plays. Trent Brown got hurt, but you look at all the decisions that were made poorly, you know, a lot of draft picks that haven't panned out, and all the things that you need to do to be a championship team that they haven't done. But still, you have two guys playing so good that almost makes up for all of it. You know, like, we keep looking at all these one score losses and saying, like, all right, there's three plays that if they go differently, this entire season is just flipped on its head. And that is what I'm holding on to, because it gives me optimism for next season, right? And just for the offseason and all of that, because they don't need to be great in the offseason. They just need to not miss on everything. Eventually, the bad luck has to run out, right? Like, you can't just run into all of these crazy, fluky scenarios and losing all these tight games in different ways, blowing it on every single free agent signing, and messing up most of your important draft picks. Eventually, things have got to start working out a little bit better. You know, that's what I'm holding on to. And then Joe and Ja'Marr is enough to pull you over that hill.
Don't let the bar go so low on you. Don't say that they do need to be great this offseason. This is a big offseason. There's a lot of ways that they could screw it up. There's a lot of things we haven't even started talking about how they could screw it up. I mean, between draft and free agency, the signing of Ja'Marr Chase has to go smoothly and happen. Don't forget that can turn into a total disaster if they can't find a way to get that done. This is going to be an insane offense. The willingness to cut the fat on this roster is going to be a big one. How many of these guys are they going to let go and move on? How the coaching decisions, all we've been talking about, all this stuff. There is a ton of things they need to do, and it does need to be great, because they're just not where they need to be as an entire team. But you're right. There is a bar if they just hit even just an average offseason, that you can see where this team, they're fun. They're just fun. It's sad to watch them go through the losing when they are playing so well. But unfortunately part of it.
You see the mic'd up segments after big scores, and you know, Joe and Ja'Marr and T get fired up after a touchdown. They're happy on the sideline. And then you juxtapose that with Joe Burrow just walking off the field, so sad at the end of games. It sucks, because he is just playing his ass off. He's just killing it. And it's fun to watch. I love watching it every week. I wish the defense was a little bit better. I wish once in a while they would hold the team under, you know, 30 points, but at least it gives me hope that they can't keep blowing everything, right? So there's got to be a little bit of luck that breaks our way with a draft pick, or we're kind of due for one of those free agent signings like a Trey Hendrickson, where it's a guy that, yeah, you can kind of make the case he's on the rise, then he just turns into a super dominant player. Like, we're due for one of those, and that's all it takes, is just another one or two of those, and then this would be a pretty dang good team.
Yeah, no, you're right though. Like, so much of the fun stuff I loved, I think I talked about this earlier in the week, but the play where Burrow gives the thumb to go over to Jamar, and then Jamar comes to the sideline like, you were crazy with that damn thumb. I knew the thumb was over. Like, these are great moments that you want to hear more about, that you want to focus on and expound on, but you can't because they're after the game, they're sad and they're and depressed and talking trash about the coach. And like, it's just like, it makes it hard to enjoy the great moments. There's no question as a fan.
What was your big story this week?
Mine is the continued downfall of Cam Taylor-Britt that continues to bring me incredible guilt. Because I wrote the story in week two. Everybody was on, like, I didn't make up the story. This was not a fiction piece. I mean, I wrote the story after he has a good game in Kansas City. He has that crazy interception. It really felt like, okay, here comes Cam Taylor-Britt. And everybody you talked to was like, man, he's coming into his own. Here we go. He's matured. So I write the big story. And like from that moment forward, it has just been awful. And he's now become this year's scapegoat. You know, last year, Dax Hill and Nick Scott, kind of with Dax taking a lot of the heat there, that was kind of the scapegoat of last year's season. Cam certainly taking the heat. He certainly did after the Chargers game where he was benched again. And Lou Anarumo got a little bit more specific with exactly kind of what happened before it, and pointed out that the first touchdown, which was the one that was up the seam where it kind of came in between Cam and Geno Stone and over top of Jermaine Pratt. First of all, an incredible throw by Justin Herbert, but his point was, this is something we'd showed them multiple times during the week, worked on a couple of times on exactly where your depth needs to be so that you can make sure they can't hit that. And he just wasn't there. He wasn't in the spot that we talked about and needed to be. Either that kind of started it, that was part of the flare-ups on the sideline, got everybody kind of going like, you got to be kidding me. And then the next drive, a play that goes, the one that went up the corner that it looks like Logan's chasing it, and Geno Stone's trying to come over, and you're like, why is nobody else out there? That's because Cam Taylor-Britt was supposed to be out there. He ran across in a man coverage, essentially forgetting he was supposed to just drop deep there and sit in the zone, and just totally MA'd, and ends up with a guy just running free into the end zone. And like, that's two plays in a row, two chunk touchdowns that are given up, and that's the ball game right there. Like, yeah. The point is, it's just such an inconsistent roller coaster with him of not knowing what it is. And I just, you hear him go through that, and yet you have to, you can't continue to play a guy who's playing like that in that type of a spot, and this stuff that it continues to go on. I just feel guilt. This is just,
as you should.
You know, usually I feel like I felt like it's gone. Usually I feel like I've done a good job of writing things that end up kind of, oh, here's a trend. And I make a habit of retweeting of things that, whether it was like, oh, Jamar after the catch, or moving Jamar around, look, there's that again, or T. Higgins after the catch, whatever we're talking about, Burrow doing, his back shoulder throws, like stuff that I'm like, oh yeah, let's keep retweeting that when it keeps happening. And now I'm like, I don't think I've had a single second, nor would I ever retweet that Cam Taylor-Britt story again, because it went the opposite way after that, which is that goes to show kind of how shocking it has been internally that has happened.
And it's also, like you said, you're not alone on that. There was so much Cam Taylor-Britt hype coming into this season. And, a lot of talk about, like, he might be one of these expensive free agents that the Bengals have to make a decision on, like the next T. Higgins or Jesse Bates. Like, what are you going to do with CTB here? So you weren't alone on that. And I do think there's an important distinction to be made here for your guilt. Some of your stories, like you said, you're dead on. These are good stories, like the Jamar stuff. Like, you're very in-depth, the four-part T. Higgins thing. You're good with the stories. Where you kind of are off are your predictions. Your predictions, like the Jets and the Super Bowl. And
yeah, hey, wait a minute. I thought we're bringing the Jets back. Don't keep holding the Jets over my head.
The Super Bowl pick. I mean, listen, there's some picks we could. Then again, even at the live show, we had some of those media people making new predictions, right, to go on the record for the rest of the season. I think James, his big hot take for the second half of the season was Evan McPherson will not miss another field goal. And then immediately just misses two in the next game, just immediately. So I guess you're not alone in the predictions being off this season, because
yeah,
people still feel like, yeah, you know, as bad as Evan had been, he's going to get it together, because we know what he is. And we thought we knew what Cam Taylor-Britt was after those first few seasons. You kind of saw the progression, and it makes no sense for him to just fall off as much as he has and just be clueless out there sometimes. I don't get it.
It's befuddling, you know. It just feels like it's a mental block at this point, or just you lose your confidence, and he's such a confident guy. And if you don't feel like you're out there totally sure of what you're doing and believing what you're doing all the time, you get in your head and you just keep messing up, and then it feels like it's snowballed for him at this point. But guess what? Doesn't matter. Not going to stay on the sidelines, because they have to have him now. DJ Turner goes on IR. Looks like his season's probably over with that broken clavicle. They signed up a guy named Marco Wilson, who for a waiver claim this time of year has a decent amount of skins on the wall. He's started a bunch of games for a couple of teams. So at least you get somebody with some experience that has played in this league. It's not like somebody who you're pulling off another team's practice squad with no snaps or starts. He's played a ton in this league. So, and he's only 25 years old. So maybe they can get some kind of depth there. Josh Newton's getting his chance though. Like, that's sort of the next wave of what's going to happen in the secondary now, is you're going to get Josh Newton starting across from Cam Taylor-Britt. And Josh has impressed them with the way he's played the last couple of weeks and kind of grown his opportunity. And maybe he can be the next guy to show hope and then fall off the next year.
Yeah, you know, maybe Chris Jenkins too. Maybe he can start to flash and we'll get super hyped about some defensive line solutions, and then like he can also be part of that fall off a few years from now, you know.
I mean, it's true. I mean, DJ Turner and Cam Taylor-Britt, man, came out hot. Oh, look at these young guys. Here's the future. And they've both now, you know, although DJ, you have to, the moment you start playing well, to make sure you get hurt. That's kind of the thing. Dapping to Dax Hill as he was really coming on. And now the same thing with DJ Turner, having Lou Anarumo even called it this week, probably his best game as a Bengal. And that's right when he gets hurt. So kind of the way it's gone back there this year.
Trent Brown, he was playing football and then he got hurt for this season, you know. And
I remember when Trent Brown was a part of the answer. I remember that. That was a good moment.
He had a good run. Good run for Trent Brown. Good run. Great camp. Good couple games for him. Real strong effort. What's wrong with the Michigan guys getting hurt? I feel like maybe that's the trend of these defensive players from Michigan. Dax goes down. DJ goes down. What are they doing up there?
I don't know.
Let's start blaming the trainers in Michigan.
Chris Jenkins hurt his thumb on the sled.
Oh, like, that's true. I forgot about that.
So, I mean, it's just, I don't know. It's just part of the, I thought they were supposed to be the tough guys, right?
Yeah. What are they, soft now? Come on.
Must be soft. All right. But time for me to rank your tweets. You had a few different ones, both from the game and in some of the fallout. I'll start with this one. Everyone, last week we banished people to the Jermaine Burton slot machine when they deserved it. But I enjoyed this. Everyone responsible for ruining career seasons from Burrow, Chase, and Hendrickson should be banished to the Frisch's cage. And had the picture of the Frisch's cage. I don't know if people have seen this, but I love the cage where all of the old big boys are hanging out. That's a fantastic area. What's happening with those? Can we acquire a big boy? Like,
we should
auction those off. I would love to have a big boy.
Think about what kind of flags you could fly off a big boy in your front yard. You know,
I wouldn't even diminish the big boy stands alone, but I just want him greeting people like right in the middle of my front yard.
You could just get two just to flank the door as people enter your house.
Yeah. Forget plants. No, let's go two giant big boys. I need to know if anybody's listening that knows how I can acquire one of those big boys and pull it out of the cage without just like, you know, climbing the fence and pulling off a big boy heist.
Well, it sounds like you could probably just acquire an entire Frisch's restaurant on the cheap these days. Like, if you want to just go for the whole thing, just take it all.
I'm in for it. So I enjoyed that. I enjoyed that. That's the new place people can be banished to. Is that above or below the Jermaine Burton slot machine to be?
Yeah, I think the Burton slot machine, you're right, is more the timeout. You know, you get to really think about what you did wrong, and there's a chance for redemption. You know, Burton had a couple nice plays at the start of the game, didn't finish it well against the Chargers, but you know, there's still hope after the Burton slot machine. Once you're in the Frisch's cage, you're just done. You're locked up with the other failed big boys there. And the road out is long and hard and requires lots of effort.
Yeah, no. So we'll see who ends up in the Frisch's big boy cage going forward. It might be the next tweet. What caused Sheldon Rankins to get sick and miss such a big game? Did he watch his 2024 game film?
Burn.
Yeah, that feels personal and but on point. You know, he is really an under-discussed epic fail.
From
this season. Like, we don't spend. It's sort of like all of these defensive linemen. Like, you rarely spend much time talking about defensive tackles. They're supposed to be kind of in a more anonymous position, but not this guy. He wasn't supposed to be in an anonymous position, but you have gotten we've gotten one sack.
Yeah.
And you've gotten very little disruption. And now you've gotten a guy who they said they're trying to get to the bottom of what his illness was. He could be very sick. I don't want to diminish anything there, but it just adds to the disappointment of what this season has been from a guy that they really counted on to come in and be a disruptor and just ain't.
Seeing him wearing the same number as DJ Reader had. Like, I'm used to seeing that big number in the middle making plays, and now the guy's just not a factor at all. And they overpaid for him probably because there weren't a lot of great defensive line options. But still, like, I give you crap sometimes for your Miles Murphy sack prediction, but a lot was expected out of Sheldon Rankins, and man, he just hasn't been there. And yeah, that tweet was sort of impulsive when, like, that came out of nowhere, right? Like, that wasn't something that we were following much. The illness thing kind of hit him.
No, totally out of nowhere. And to the point that he was an illness and then questionable. So you thought, oh, maybe he just woke up with some kind of food thing or whatever.
Get some IVs.
But then he actually ends up not playing. And you're like, goodness gracious.
And it's just the most important game, season's on the line. And when those guys aren't out there, it sucks. I mean, Orlando Brown, like, I was hoping he might get to play too. Didn't, but that looked a little less optimistic. Like, he was going to be out there. And, you know, not that Cody Ford is the worst, you know, he's not the best, but he's done a little bit better than I expected him to do. But the fact that Orlando Brown was having just like a Pro Bowl season and then got hurt and dropped off, like, that kind of sucks too. Like, the biggest game of the season, you need those big guys out there. There's not that many really good players on this team. So to lose one in Orlando Brown, that sucks. And for Sheldon Rankins to just never become one, that is just such a blow.
Yeah. Your last, my number one from the week is, at least the 2024 Bengals can't hurt you anymore.
Yeah. The way that, you know, it's such a great comeback. And then again, one more time, we had to get burned. Everybody wrote the season off in the first half. Like, man, the coach has got to go. The front office sucks. The ownership is terrible, blah, blah, blah. And then all of a sudden they start making plays. They start creeping back in. They get the fumble. Joe and Jamar are linking it. And then Evans missing field goals. And it just falls apart again at the end. And they just, at least we can't have that anymore. We watch the games a different way now.
I mean, this has got to be the most frustrating, demoralizing season, because you can see the joy. It's different when, like, they're just terrible, but you can see the joy you could be having. You feel the moments of excitement, but you just never get the, like, conclusion that you want. You know, you never get that moment of, oh, here we come, or yeah, they did it. You just get the, like, the middle moments of, oh, that's exciting, but you never get the finish. You only get the pain and the disbelief, and then the frustration of feeling like you're ruining your best players in the process. This is truly as hurtful and painful from a fan perspective, I'm sure, as you can potentially have. Like, there's nothing worse than seeing the possibility of greatness and realizing that everyone else is ruining it.
I mean, Evan McPherson makes one of those kicks and the end of that game is much different. And if you win that going into the bye week, think of where that the team is mentally. Like, everything's still in front of you. There's a lot of optimism coming back in that fashion. You know, you have the offense making play after play and the defense finally showing some signs of life. You could build off that. Pittsburgh's coming to town. Like, that could be, you know, a lot more optimism around that. But it just, they just keep breaking your heart, and that's it.
All right. just, I think that sound kind of sums up where Bengals fans are at right now. It's 100%. Just, you just talk yourself into a tizzy and then deep sigh.
Well, we've got questions. Right. You ready for some?
Well, hold on. First, we got to talk
about our guy.
Our guy, your guy, the Growl Pal guy, Keller Williams. You know him. Eric Stanio, king of, can we call him king of Cincinnati real estate? I think so. Always want to do that. I feel like it.
I don't even know who else is in contention.
He's got great hats that are very popular at our live shows. Nobody wants anything more than the bridge hats, which are awesome. Mm-hmm. But if you can, you know, join the Stanio clan, yo. You can subscribe to his YouTube channel at Team Stanio, S-Z-T-A-N-Y-O. Anything you want to know about Cincinnati real estate, markets, schools, trends, you name it. It's all up there. He's done tons of stuff there on the YouTube page. So go to at Team Stanio there on YouTube. Check him out. He's got tons of subscribers. You can also follow E Stanio on Instagram. Look, when housing affordability is being stretched to its limits, you need a trusted guide who can answer all of your real estate questions. Eric is your guy. He's our guy. He's a Growl Pal. So if you or someone you know is looking to buy or sell, email directly info@teamstanio.com or go to www.teamstanio.com to connect with our guy. Or you can just send to the Growler Podcast at gmail.com and we'll let him know too, because he's our guy.
And that's one of the biggest purchases, one of the biggest decisions that people make, buying or selling a house. You got to go with somebody that knows what they're doing, right? Because everyone has a realtor in their orbit. You know, a person that you went to high school with that is transitioning from her Etsy shop to now being a real estate agent. They're like, is that who you're going to trust selling your house? Well, go with somebody that knows what they're doing, knows the market, and is a Growl Pal.
Yeah, love it. Absolutely. All right, what do you got for me this week?
All right, we're going to kick things off with Mike from Jersey. He says he's a longtime listener, first-time emailer, so thank you, Mike. He says he thinks it's appropriate to start talking coaching changes at this point in the season. He said, on driving to work today, I thought, wow, wouldn't Bill Belichick be a great head coach for the Bengals? He'd probably favor coming here because the elite quarterback's already in place. Why would he want to become a head coach for a team with a top five draft pick and roll the dice on a rookie QB with this upcoming draft? There's also other pieces on this roster that might attract him, both offensive tackles, Hendrickson, Chase. Can you please just ruin my dream and tell me it will never happen?
I don't think it will happen. First of all, I want to say this first, and I understand, and have no problem talking about what's on your guys' mind. You guys are wanting to talk about coaching changes and the possible. I'm not going to do this every week. We've talked a lot about Lou Anarumo here last week. I talked about him earlier this week on Balls Don't Lie. We talked about the possibility that looks to be, if you were placing a bet on what the big move in terms of coaching looks like, that would be the one that looks the most likely. There were a long way from anybody having answers on that right now. I just don't want to sit here and answer, are they going to fire Zach every single week? Like, happy, we're gonna have the conversation. It's gonna go there. We talk about it. I try to answer it when you can. It's just, I understand people are mad about it, but also understand that it doesn't really do any good to continue to just yell about the same thing and speculate over and over again. I will answer your question. Bill Belichick, I obviously, the way he worked with Tom Brady, the connections between Burrow and Brady in terms of personality, the way they are, ability to carry the offense while Belichick carries the defense and the overall team. Yes, obviously it makes sense. I just don't see it. I don't see that mesh with this ownership. You know, him sitting down and the Brown family giving up all decision-making, which is something that Belichick's going to want to do, what that relationship would be like, his want to do that. He has a ton of respect. I mean, Paul Brown's one of his favorite people in the world and one of the most influential people in football. It's certainly a great place to start. He's a legendary Hall of Fame coach. He also was having a whole lot of problems in New England and was kind of a big part of the reason why they got run out of there. And so I just don't see how that relationship between the ownership and family and Belichick would fit. To answer your question on my feeling, I don't see that. Second of all, I don't expect Zach to be fired. Like, I don't look. Dave Shula went 19-52. 52 losses. Okay. I mean, the amount of patience. Sam Weish was 64-68. Marvin was 131-129-3. Okay. He was here for 16 years and never won a playoff game. Zach Taylor had some of the best chemistry and culture that they've had here, and was one of the two best back-to-back seasons they've ever had here just 2 years ago. Okay. That, I'm not saying that it hasn't, there aren't things that have gone sideways and that he's beyond reproach because of that, but understand how recent that is in Mike Brown and the family's mind. Okay. That is, that just happened. And that got him that close to a Super Bowl. He has a great relationship with Joe Burrow. So those two things are, they have a top five offense. This offense is amongst the best the franchise has ever had right now in terms of the way that it's playing. And I know people just say it's because of Joe Burrow. I mean, he is the play caller. When the plays don't go well, he gets trashed, right? But when they have a top five offense and they're scoring all these points all the time, he gets no credit, and that's fine. I don't think that's something that he's even after, but like, there's also has to go both ways. What are we judging a play caller on other than how many points you're scoring? I don't know what else I'm supposed to judge it on. And their offense is great right now. So all of those things, I just don't see it. I don't see anything like that happening. And so we can yell about that all you want to. I'm here to tell you the reality as I see it. I don't see that happening. And I'm not going to continue to go down it every single week. I understand the questions. I appreciate the questions, but it just ends up being a lot to continue to just yell fire Zach Taylor every single week. We know how how people feel about that.
Well, it's fun to daydream like, oh, I wonder what it would be like with Bill Belichick. But also, He did have a rough end at the end of his time in New England. So even if the team was going to give him all the control he wanted, there's no clear belief that he would necessarily change everything around overnight and be what he was during the peak Brady Patriots era. That Bill B might be gone. You know, like, there weren't a lot of teams beating down his door to get him in this past offseason. So I don't know that,
and maybe they regret that. Maybe teams look at it, and he's refreshing his image as this media guy now, right? And he's trying to be like, show that he's likable, and clearly that's his objective. I mean, he's on every single show you could possibly be on, and trying to reconnect and be this cool guy because he felt like people viewed him as this old curmudgeon who was out of touch. And maybe that's worked. And I think people are that are looking for culture changers is the big theme. We've heard, I know Diana Rossini on Scoop City has talked a lot about that, about how, oh yeah, that's going to be the theme of the offseason coaching changes, is people looking for culture changers and less for the hotshot offensive play caller, which is where Belichick fits in. And so, especially if you end up in some kind of a bidding war situation, you know, that's also unlikely to happen. But I'm interested to see how many coaching changes are out there and how much Belichick is sought after his market was pretty tepid last year.
We're going to stay on the coaching train with this next one from another Mike. He says, perhaps I'm oversimplifying the Zach Taylor and Lou Anarumo disdain, but wouldn't the front office want to be really sure that Joe Burrow especially, and maybe Ja'Marr Chase, are on board with the head coach, whether it's Zach or someone else? I feel like if I have Joe Burrow, I'm saying, hey, Joe, you want this guy or another guy? And if you want someone else, that's it. If he soured on Zach and thinks a culture change is needed, shouldn't that be enough?
Yeah. I don't think Joe would say that. I mean, Joe, if there's ever anybody, and you never know how anybody, you know, when they're alone in their house feels about a coworker or about their boss or whatever, but there has been zero impression ever that Joe Burrow doesn't love having Zach Taylor as his head coach. Like, zero. And what, you know what Joe wants to go do? Throw the ball a million times and rack up yards. And Zach allows that. Zach realizes that's our way to win. Zach Taylor says, I'm going to let Joe Burrow throw it if we need to go throw it, and makes that happen. And so You don't think that Joe loves that? Joe doesn't love the sway he has organizationally, which is massive. You don't think he doesn't think he might lose some of that sway if somebody else comes in there? I just think he's very comfortable with Zach Taylor as his head coach. They've built an offense around Burrow's skill set, and he's a quarterback guy. There's a comfort level there. And again, I don't know. I don't know what Joe Burrow thinks when he is sitting in his house counting his millions of dollars and checking out backless suits and doing everything in the off season. I don't know. But I can only go by what we've ever heard and seen, and is that he seems to have a fantastic relationship with Zach Taylor and seems to really enjoy him being his head coach and want him to be his head coach. He talked about it being the best situation he could have ever come into with Zach Taylor as head coach. He said that multiple times. So I don't, if you ask Joe, what would he say? I mean, Jamar pops off all the time. So I take that with a little more of a grain of salt than I do if Joe Burrow would have been saying the things that Jamar Chase said or has said. I mean, Jamar popped off in his second game as a pro about play calling. Like, I mean, that's just, he's just a guy that says stuff. You know what I mean? And that's okay. I love it. But I mean, it'd be a little different if you were hearing anything resembling like that from Joe, and we haven't.
I also feel like that's got to be tougher for a quarterback to go to really have that feeling about the only coach he's had in the NFL. You know, the guy that brought him in, the guy he's worked with. It's not like Joe's an experienced vet that's played in multiple teams, different systems, different coaches. And he's like, yeah, this hotshot new guy, he's not working out. Let's get rid of this dude and bring in somebody I know from, you know, back in the day.
And it's so true that whatever Joe wants is probably what's going to happen. I mean, the last thing they can do, look, you don't think, you guys all talk about it. You guys send me questions about it. I see you on all the social medias platforms that we're on now talking about, look, is Joe getting Carsoned, right? Is he turning into Carson Palmer? Well, you know, a quick way to turn him into Carson Palmer is to get rid of what he feels like is his biggest ally and his head coach, if that is truly the way that he feels. If he does feel like he needs a change and you don't give it to him, then there's a frustration that could come in there. But if you then take away somebody who feels like his ally number one here and the one that's working with him the most, then you push him much quicker into a Carson Palmer direction, which is a big part. You know, I certainly don't want to relitigate the late 2000s. However, I do believe that disconnect between Marvin Lewis and Carson Palmer and ownership all working together was a big part of what disenfranchised Carson at that time. And maybe if they would have moved on and brought in a new head coach at that point, maybe an offensive guy that Carson could have had, that maybe that would have gone a long way to helping him out. Again, I don't want to relitigate that, but I'm just saying that's a very, very careful situation when you start talking about what Joe wants. And he's going to get pretty much whatever he wants. And I think,
unless it's T. Higgins,
we know he'll want, unless it's T. Higgins. Yes. Unless it's T. Higgins. That's fair.
We have another coaching question. Last coaching question for you. And first off, this guy wants to start off by saying he was at the zoo a few weeks ago. You were talking about the zoo on our last show.
Yeah.
Hear the gibbon, but did notice the animals were especially active, including a rhino that was constantly pacing, which was unsettling to watch. I have to wonder if the time change has messed up the animals' moods. I'm a therapist and wish I had Dr. Doolittle powers to know what has been going on. I don't know about the time change really affecting the zoo employees so much in their cages.
Do we think the animals know, like, about time change? Are they aware of how it works? Leap years? Do you think they get thrown off by leap years?
Like, our clocks are all thrown off. This is crazy. There's too many. Know. Yeah, their work day gets shifted. Now there's people there later.
All right, but his coaching question. Reach out to us. We want to hear from all of our zoologist growl pals about how animals react to the time change.
Yeah, we're going to look dumb if there's somebody that's like, actually, that does affect them because people show up later, their meal times have changed, and this and that. We're just like, yeah, right. What, do they got to sit their watches back? Come on, it's a rhino. But his coaching question, he said, Is one positive spin of this year's struggles that Dan Pitcher is now less sought out as a head coach? I attribute a lot of this offseason's offensive improvement to his influence and feel like he's better at utilizing Chase than Brian Callahan was. Coming into the season, I expected him to be one and done as a coordinator and am at least more hopeful he will stay now.
Maybe. I mean, I do think it certainly doesn't help when their team is struggling the way it is, but I think Pitcher was already pretty sought after. He's not going to leave here for anything other than a head coach job, which, you know, is, I think, known. But yeah, it's hard to sell, oh, the leader, when you're coming from a place that has, if it is the season of the culture changer, when the Bengals culture is, doesn't appear very great right now, they're losing all these close games and it's just not going well. So yeah, potentially, you know, he did kind of feel like if this team was great and had a season offensively and a playoff run, that Pitcher would be one of the hottest names. He'd be a Ben Johnson type. I don't think that's necessarily off the table with him. A lot of people are publishing their hot young candidates, coaching candidates lists right now of basically the names that are going to be in this cycle, at the front of this cycle. He's on all of them because he was, you know, so close last year. He's the OC of an awesome team. He's, his background, I mean, he is going to be a head coach, full stop, at some point. I don't think there's any doubt about that. He's too smart. His background is too perfect for what teams want in terms of personnel, personality, even keel, super smart, works with quarterbacks well, knows how to handle stars, but came from a Bengals team that's had success, been to the Super Bowl, all of that stuff. Like, he's going to be a head coach at some point. That said, yeah, I think there's a chance that certainly the way this team has played keeps him here another year. I think it probably is the year after this team makes its next playoff run, which is going to happen with Burrow. That'll probably be the year that he ends up getting the head coaching job. But you never know. Crazy things happen, right? Brian Callahan last year, you would have thought after the Super Bowl or after the year they went to the AFC Championship game, he would have got one. No, after the year they went 9-8 because they showed that they could get the most out of Jake Browning, ended up being a big difference maker for Brian. So you never know when the cycle happens what some owners are going to be looking for, or maybe they've had guys on their mind. So there's still very much a chance that Dan gets a head coaching job this offseason. But yeah, this certainly doesn't help his case.
I also don't know if that's a positive spin on the season. I would rather take the great season in losing the coordinator and having to solve that problem rather than solve all of the other problems that are facing this team this offseason. You know, I'm a Xavier basketball fan, and we went through years of losing head coaches when they were in the A-10 because, you know, the bigger conferences would poach your guy. That's just how it worked. But that's also a good problem to have, because Xavier would go to the Sweet 16, the Elite Eight, then they would lose their coach. Then they would go back to the Sweet 16. Like, you want those problems where people want your coordinators and they want the people on your staff. Like, those are good problems to have. Those are the types of problems that, you know, you should be having when you're going to the playoffs every year, making deep runs. And, you know, yeah, we can keep Pitcher around maybe another year, but I don't want to do that at the expense of going to the playoffs.
No.
Our next question is, well, we got a combo here. We've got a couple Evan questions. We got to talk about Evan. The first one's from Jen. She says, has Evan tried kicking it more to the right? He is missing in the same way most of the time. Surely that's a fairly straightforward adjustment to make. Stubbornly sticking to the same exact kick is not working. And then John, also on the Evan topic, he said that he wants to know exactly what's going on with Evan, because he ran off the field three times in that game and went to the locker room. What's going on there? And, you know, he noticed it last year too at Arizona, him running off the field multiple times. So a couple different Evan questions for you.
Yeah. He is pulling the ball to the left. I think he knows that.
Email's not going to change it all around.
I think he's well aware what's happening. I mean, it's correcting it is not easy. It's like so much. Every time I feel like we talk about kicking, I am not going to sit here and pretend that I understand kicking techniques and, you know, the different ways that, oh, how, let's look how he looks while he's following through, and is his step different, his head down. Like, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to play Hank Haney swing coach, but it all comes back to golf. Like, so often though, for me, like, you, when guys just get into a thing where their swing's just not right, the ball's just doing, it's not doing what it's supposed to do. If you look, you know, he did the same thing on one of the last PAT he made. That ball hooks on the way through, and you're like, you can see the same thing that was happening. You're right. It's just some glitch in the way he's kicking the ball right now that he's working through. He's obviously aware, like, but you get into that and it's hard to work your way out of it. And especially when it's happening in that moment. And, you know, the other question here about going to the locker room, I don't know. Maybe he had to go to the bathroom and maybe he was tight. I don't know. I don't know about the going to the law. I want to get an answer for you that we haven't talked to Evan. They went directly to the bye week. We had no player availability. He was gone after the game. So I did not see Evan after the game. We haven't talked to Darren. I don't know about the going to the locker room thing. I don't know. You have any ideas?
I think maybe there was some musical performances he wanted to watch on his phone. So he's big about loving music and seeing, you know, entertainment. As he'll never live down.
You think like Dr. Dre and Ice Cube were doing a private show back in the back locker room area? And so he was actually doing the opposite of the Super Bowl and going in. They're like, look, can you just do something for me back there? That way I don't get exposed like I did last time. So it was actually a private show happening, like in a suite or something.
What if he's just going back to the locker room and watching it on his phone? Like, still the same Super Bowl halftime show. It's the one concert he can never move on from. He's just addicted to rewatching that moment over and over.
Yeah. Good question. Noted. Put an asterisk next to it next time when we talk to Evan, which will be the next time he's around, because a lot of people have questions for him. We'll ask about that. And try to get an answer for you specifically on that one. Do you want to keep the excitement going on game day? Grab Catan Starfares and bring some extra competition to your football Sundays. While the Bengals are driving down the field, you and your crew can build, trade, and outwit each other in the ultimate game of strategy. Whether it's during halftime or postgame, Catan is the perfect time to reflect on the latest victory or defeat, I guess, and keep the excitement of competition with friends and family going. Visit CatanShop.com and use the coupon code Growler, and you'll get 10% discount on Catan for a limited time only.
You ready?
Do you have any ambush for me?
I do. Here's your ambush question this week. And, you know, you're hearing a lot of complaints, a lot of angry emails. So this is your question. How can we complain better? You know, who should be the main target of Bengals complaints? It can't be just an 80-year-old dude that's calling all the shots and pulling all the strings here. Is it the next generation of the ownership in the Brown family? Is it Duke Tobin? He catches a lot of it because the Bengals don't have a true GM. Does he really have enough leeway and sway to make all these decisions himself? Is, you know, he the reason the defense is so bad? Is it just coaching? How can I elevate my complaining to be more than just, ugh, the Bengals always suck? You know,
by reading The Athletic and listening to the Growlers, is that a good place to start?
I think so.
I think having nuance beyond yelling ownership sucks. I mean, there's and perspective, I think, is important in why things feel or look different than they did 3 years ago or 2 years ago. You know, what's the biggest difference? Because the ownership's been the same when they were as well-liked and well-run and great culture and exciting play. And it had never been more popular than they were just like 2 years ago. I mean, never.
Yeah.
And no one cared about ownership then. Everyone, oh, Elizabeth and Caroline have come in and they're young and they care about us now. And it's all great. And everybody loves this organization. And there's waiting lists for fans and everybody wants to be a sponsor and give them all the stadiums, give them four stadiums, right? Like, that was not that long ago. So with losing comes yelling about ownership. I think you got to look more at the nuances of the operation, of how they're drafting, how they're assessing, using free agency, how they're deploying players, and, you know, the dynamics of the actual team. yelling, ownership is not changing. It will not change. Everybody else in that building has to learn how to deal with that ownership, which they have won there before with it. And so I think you will hurt your throat yelling about ownership over and over again. It's pointless. The nuance is, how is everybody in the building dealing with that ownership and working around the limitations, so to speak, the ones that are going to be inherent here. And that usually comes down to the players, to the chemistry, to drafting, the development of draft picks and all that other stuff. So I think focusing on that stuff, why they've failed in free agency, why they've missed on so many offensive linemen, why the defense is not seeing development, all that stuff. That's where you need to focus your time and energy and dive and show some nuance. Don't just yell about, ownership sucks and poverty franchise and all these other things that we hear.
Yeah, and it's probably the hard part is, the true answer is, it's probably a little bit of everything. The coaching isn't the reason that they're having the season they are, but I'm sure that there are things that the coaching could be doing better that get more out of these guys maybe. And the front office probably shares some of that blame for how bad the free agency was. And ownership is what you said, everybody knows the score there. So it probably gets spread around to a lot of different places, which is why it's not easy to be like, fire the GM. That's the one guy that we can pin this whole season on. It would be a lot cleaner that way, a lot easier for us as fans, but I don't think it's just quite that simple.
Everybody's hand is in the cookie jar. That's the theme of the season. Everybody's playing a role in this, and that's the bottom line. And the other side of it is, it's just so few plays away from being such a different feel around this team, and that's just a hard thing to forget about, is how different it would be if just a few things had happened different. And they didn't, and everybody's wearing it and eating it. But, the line from Dan Pitcher of, it sucks and you want to think about taking a sledgehammer to the whole thing, but that's just not factually correct. It doesn't need that. You end up causing more problems than you do fixing.
For sure. But, there's still some happy things going on.
Oh yeah, happy things. Can we do happy things? I need some happy things. We didn't get happy enough today.
I know. And not many of them are Bengals related, of course, outside of Joe and Jamar and Trey Hendrickson, and then that's kind of it.
Yeah.
But I've got some fun shows coming up to plug for all you Growl pals. I'm going to Virginia this weekend. So tonight I'm going to be in Williamsburg and then the Columbus Funny Bone. And then next weekend I'll be at the Tacoma Comedy Club Thanksgiving weekend. So any of you people out there in the Seattle, Tacoma area can come out to those. And then the big one, December 5th through 8th, I'll be headlining Go Bananas here in Cincinnati. So all you Growl pals can come out to that.
Love it.
I did give the Growler a big shout out on last Friday.
You did. I was in the house. Myself and my wife had date night. We went to Josh Sneed's special down at Memorial Hall. You opened. You crushed, by the way.
Thank you.
The crowd was hyped, man. The crowd was ready that night. They were ready to show up and support local comedy. You and Josh both crushed it, and you gave a Growler shout out in the middle of one of your bits. You had specifically told people not to necessarily yell woo, and it took I felt like I was supposed to yell woo when you dropped that Growler in, and I didn't, and I kind of had regrets, but I wasn't sure what my decorum was supposed to be.
Yeah, you're like Ted Karras when Joe Burrow gets hit after the whistle. He's like, man, I wish I had that one back. I wish I had wooed in the middle of that show. I would have done it differently if I was given the chance. But yeah, I made sure everybody was on their best behavior. But I still slid it in there. Still slid in the Growler shout out since it was a local show and you were in the house. Tip of the cap for you on that one. And it was a hot show. It was a great
show. And that will be out as a special, right? That'll be everywhere. Josh will have that. So just if you know Josh, if you know our show, Cincy Shirts, everything else. So look out for that. His special coming out. It was awesome. So I highly recommend anybody to make sure you check that out when it comes out. Dad life. Do you have any dad life?
Right now, we are trying just to stay healthy. That is the goal, because we have hit that point in the school year where all the chips are starting to fall around us. You know, there we got the email from the middle kid's teacher that said we're having the whooping cough is going around the school. And we have no confirmed cases in our classroom, but half of the class is currently out sick. A few more went home sick that day. So, like, all of it's starting to fall apart with that kid. The older kid, her best friend, has now been out sick for 3 days. The youngest is in preschool. Two of them are in gymnastics. Germs are at an all-time high, and we are just trying to hang on just to get through the Thanksgiving holiday. Personally, I hope I can at least get through the next few weeks since I've got so much travel going on and a lot of shows in these next few weeks. But that's the downside. This time of year when you have young kids, man, the illness comes hard and it comes frequently. And I feel like we're just in the matrix, just kind of like dodging all the germs that are around us right now, just hanging on.
No, there is nothing worse than when everybody starts getting sick and you're just, it's just brutal. We are going on vacation this week, and we've had multiple times when we've done this trip where we've gone, cause my wife's family is from Philadelphia. And we've gone on this trip and someone has gotten sick, or we've had to go to an urgent care in Pittsburgh. I feel like every time that somebody gets sick or we end up fighting this stuff, because it's that time of year where it's just absolutely everywhere and it just breaks everybody down. It runs through the family. And then you're like, what happened? Do you guys remember the last month? Because I don't. All I remember is just all of us being sick constantly. I'm excited. I do want to ask, we are going on vacation. We're going to Hocking Hills, and we're going to New York City with kids. Nice. We have friends that live right on the route of the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. And so they were like, look, we give you an invitation and you can come in and you can watch them like blow them up on Wednesday night, watch the parade go on Thursday morning. And so we got a day or two built around that though in New York. Anybody has any ideas? We have some, but I want to, if people know that have done things with kids, my kids are 7 and 5 in New York City, let's hear them. I'm here for you. I want to know. Send it to thegrowlerpodcast@gmail.com. We've got our list of things to do, but you guys always come through with cool ideas and things that you've done. So if you've got some, I'm reaching out. I'm reaching out for help. Let us know what you've got. But outside of that, we are excited. I always love this. I started baking this into the schedule for me a few years ago after the Super Bowl year, when it's like, man, these seasons go so long. You need the break in the middle. So I always have been putting in a little bit of a break around Thanksgiving to just get away for a little bit. And I appreciate everybody that hangs with us. And of course, everybody, you know, the Growler team has you guys covered. There'll be tons of content still coming your way next week, so you're not missing out on any of that. But I'm looking forward to it. Send me your ideas.
I mean, is this their first time in New York?
Yes.
So doing the parade stuff, that's going to be huge anyway. Like, you're going to win there.
That alone. I mean, that really is the like A1 highlight. I mean, to the point that we're basically kind of doing it twice, because Wednesday night we're going to go watch and blow them up, and then Thursday morning go watch the actual parade. So that's the big thing, but we're going to go, I mean, and see all that. I mean, there's so much, especially they're set up for Christmas everywhere there now.
Yeah. The little Christmas markets, got a lot of Midtown.
Yeah, all that stuff. That's where we're staying down there in Midtown. So I think we'll be pretty covered to get around and stuff like that. But I'm here for any ideas that anybody has.
Send them to thegrowlerpodcast@gmail.com along with your questions that Jay and I will have to get to next week.
Yeah, absolutely. Will do. All right, Mark, appreciate it. Mm-hmm. We will see you on the flip side. Have a good one, everybody.